takers and thieves, for the worthless the least. You have said that our judgment is death for all eternity, without hope, without rest. Oh, what an amazing mystery. What an amazing mystery.
Good morning. And welcome here this morning as we celebrate God's grace for us as a people awaiting Christ's second coming because of the grace he's given us through the first coming, which we have celebrated just recently in Easter, the death and resurrection of our Lord. So welcome to all of you here this morning. It's a wonderful opportunity we have in freedom God has given us at this time in history, in this place, to proclaim God's grace to one another and to the world around us, to be equipped to go forth and to serve him in all the different ways that he calls us to serve. And this morning also we're going to be installing new elders and deacons for terms of service in a specific way that they serve in leading us as servant leaders in this church. So, no, it's not the male choir this morning. Sorry, guys. But we'll be able to share in what God has been doing in that as well. Let's begin in a song that reminds us of what we're longing for. We live in a time that's in between, where God has come in Christ, has offered us salvation, has worked it in us by his Holy Spirit through faith that we have been given and grace that we are living out of, but yet it's always incomplete and it's always a struggle as we struggle with our sinful nature. We will look at that again a little further in the message as we continue our Genesis series. But it's a call, it's a song that calls us back to focus on the God of our future as well as our present, who has taken care of our past as well. Let's sing together.
Every valley will be lifted high, and the weak will be the strong. When you come like lightning in the sky, how long, O Lord, how long? Kings on earth will scatter when they hear thundering sounds of angel songs. Hearts will tremble filled with holy fear. Along, O Lord.
stand together and receive God's word of greeting from Jude, verse 1 and 2. Our Lord welcomes us with these words: to those who have been called, who are loved by God the Father, and kept by Jesus Christ through the indwelling of his Holy Spirit, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. God's people say, Amen.
Give and take away. You give and take away. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
We approach the time of installation of elders and deacons. The form can be found on the Psalter Hymnal, page 1004. There's a few little updates from a more recent version that are in mine, but it's basically the same one. Page 1004 if you want to follow along. Congregation of Jesus Christ, today we celebrate God's gift of faithful leadership for his people. We joyfully thank him for the elders and deacons who have served well and completed their terms of office. So we'd like to praise the Lord and thank George DeRue, Peter Glasbergen, Ed Slappendell, Leo DeVries, and Frank Vrates. And realizing, actually, George was going to share a little bit this morning, but he became sick, been sick, so he can't. But I wanted to just express our thankfulness as a congregation to the Lord who through you has served us. So maybe we could give just a round of applause thanking those who have served. Thank you. And now we praise the Lord for providing their successors. So in the office bearers of the church, we see the love of Christ for his people. As the Lord of the church, he appoints leaders and by his Spirit equips them so that believers may grow in faith, develop disciplined Christian living, serve others in selfless love, and share with all the good news of salvation. I hope you caught that. The Lord appoints leaders and by his Spirit equips them so that believers, all of us, may do those things, may grow in those things. Now he taught us the spirit of true leadership when he said in Matthew 20, "Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first among you must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Now elders serve by governing the church in Christ's name. They received this task when Christ entrusted the apostles and their successors with the keys of the kingdom of heaven. You find that in Matthew 16, verse 19. Elders are thus responsible for the spiritual well-being of God's people. They must provide true preaching and teaching, regular celebration of the sacraments, and faithful counsel and discipline while keeping in confidence those matters entrusted to them. And they must promote fellowship and hospitality among believers, ensure good order in the church, and stimulate witness to all people. Deacons serve by showing mercy to the church and to all people. They received this task in the early church when the apostles designated special persons for the work of mercy, and find that in Acts 6 and in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. In Christ's name, the deacons relieve victims of injustice. By this, they show that Christians live by the spirit of the kingdom, fervently desiring to give life the shape of things to come. Deacons are therefore called to assess needs, promote stewardship and hospitality, collect and disperse resources for benevolence, and develop programs of assistance. They are also called to speak words of Christian encouragement. Thus, in word as well as deed, they demonstrate the care of the Lord Himself. These tasks of elders and deacons call for believers who are Christ-like, who are mature in the faith, and who exercise their offices with prayer, patience, and humility. Now, we intend to ordain elders and deacons and to install them for terms of service in this congregation. Those appointed to the office of elder are Rudy Boverhoff, Kevin DeBoer, Jerry Kears, and Peter Wieringa. You want to make your way up here? And those appointed to the office of deacon are James Vanderveen and Lloyd Wieringa. I'm going to join up here as well. Now, to express your acceptance of these offices, you're asked to stand and hear in the presence of God and His people to answer the following questions. Do you believe that in the call of this congregation, God Himself is calling you to these holy offices? Do you believe that the Old and New Testaments are the Word of God, the only infallible rule of faith and life? Do you subscribe to the doctrinal standards of this church, rejecting all teaching which contradicts them? And do you promise to do the work of your offices faithfully in a way worthy of your calling and in submission to the government and discipline of the church? Kevin DeBoer, what is your answer? Peter Wieringa, what is your answer? Rudy Boverhoff, what is your answer?
I do, God helping me.
Jerry Kears, what is your answer?
I do, God helping me.
Lloyd Wieringa, what is your answer?
I do, God helping me.
James Vanderveen, what is your answer?
I do, God helping me.
May God, our Heavenly Father, who has called you to these sacred offices, guide you by His Word, equip you with His Spirit, and so prosper your ministries that His church may increase and His name be praised. God's people say, Amen. At this time, I'm going to invite each of them to come and sign. This is the covenant for office bearers in the Christian Reformed Church. So if you want to just find your name on the list and sign just above your name. And while you're doing that, I'll read to you what they are signing. It says, "We, the undersigned, believe the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the inspired Word of God, which proclaims the good news of God's creation and redemption through Jesus Christ. Acknowledging the authority of God's Word, we submit to it in all matters of life and faith. We affirm three creeds, the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, and the Athanasian Creed, as ecumenical expressions of the Christian faith. In doing so, we confess our faith in unity with followers of Jesus Christ throughout all ages and among all nations. We also affirm three confessions, the Belgic Confession, the Heidelberg Catechism, and the Canons of Dort, as historic Reformed expressions of the Christian faith, whose doctrines fully agree with the Word of God. These confessions continue to define the way we understand Scripture, direct the way we live in response to the Gospel, and locate us within the larger body of Christ. And grateful for these expressions of faith, we promise to be formed and governed by them. We heartily believe and will promote and defend their doctrines faithfully, conforming our preaching and teaching, writing, serving, and living to them. Along with these historic creeds and confessions, we also recognize the witness of Our World Belongs to God, a Contemporary Testimony, as a current Reformed expression of the Christian faith that forms and guides us in our present context. We also promise to present or receive confessional difficulties in a spirit of love and fellowship with our brothers and sisters, as together we seek a fuller understanding of the Gospel. Should we come to believe that a teaching in the confessional documents is not the teaching of God's Word, we will communicate our views to the Church according to the procedures prescribed by the Church Order and its supplements. And if the Church asks, we will give a full explanation of our views. And further, we promise to submit to the Church's judgment and authority. We honor this covenant for the well-being of the Church, to the glory of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit." This is the covenant for office bearers in the Christian Reformed Church that all ordained office bearers are required to sign in order to guide us in how we are called to lead. At this time, I'm going to invite who are elders and deacons who are present here today who are continuing on in office to come join us up here. So come on up. And we have the charge to the elders and the charge to the deacons. So I'm going to make a little group this way of the deacons, go that way a little bit further. Just come up, stand with them. The deacons on that side, elders over here. To the elders, I charge you elders, too, as it says in Acts 20, guard yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. And be a friend and Christ-like example to children. Give clear and cheerful guidance to young people. By word and example, bear up God's people in their pain and weakness and celebrate their joys with them. Hold in trust all sensitive matters confided to you. Encourage the aged to persevere in God's promises. Be wise counselors who support and strengthen the pastor. Be compassionate, yet firm and consistent in rebuke and discipline. And know the scriptures, which are, as it says in 2 Timothy 3:16, useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Pray continually for the church. Remember at all times that if you would truly give spiritual leadership in the household of faith, you must be completely mastered by your Lord, as it says in 1 Timothy 3. And I charge you, deacons, to inspire faithful stewardship in this congregation. Remind us that from everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. Teach us to be merciful. Prompt us to seize new opportunities to worship God with offerings of wealth, time, and ability. Realize that benevolence is a quality of our life in Christ and not merely a matter of financial assistance. Therefore, minister to rich and poor alike, both within and outside the church. Weigh the needs of causes and use the church's resources discerningly. Be compassionate to the needy. Respect their need for dignity. Hold in trust all sensitive matters confided to you. Encourage them with words that create hope in their hearts and with deeds that bring joy into their lives. Be prophetic critics of the waste, injustice, and selfishness in our society, and be sensitive counselors to the victims of such evils. Let your lives be above reproach. Live as examples of Christ Jesus and look to the interests of others. And I invite you as congregation to stand as I have a charge for you as well, the question after which you can answer with "We do," God helping us. And I charge you, people of God, to receive these office bearers as Christ's gift to the church. Recognize in them the Lord's provision for healthy congregational life. Hold them in honor. Take their counsel seriously. Respond to them with obedience and respect. Accept their help with thanks. Sustain them in prayer and encourage them with your support, especially when they feel the burden of their office. Acknowledge them as the Lord's servants among you. Do you, congregation, pledge to receive them as you have been charged? What is your answer? You may be seated. I'm going to invite the incoming office bearers to come here and to kneel here, and then the other ones to come around them as we pray. Just come real close together. If you gentlemen would kneel, take a knee. The rest of you come around them. Lay your hands on them as we pray. Merciful Father in heaven, we thank you that you have provided faithful and gifted people to serve as elders and deacons. As these new office bearers assume their responsibilities, fill them with your Spirit. Endow them with your wisdom and grant them strength. Make them faithful workers in your vineyard. Under their guidance, may your church grow in every spiritual grace, in faith which is open and unashamed, and in the committed service that promotes your reign in the world. Help them to perform their duties with enthusiasm and humility. In their work, grant them a sense of sustained awe, which is rooted in daily adoration of you, their Lord. Through them, may your name be honored and your church be served. And help us, your people, to accept them gladly, encourage them always, and respect them for the sake of your precious Son, our Lord, in whose name we pray, and God's people say, Amen. Thank you. You may return to your families. We're going to stand together and we're going to sing our children's song, This Little Light of Mine, a very simple understanding and a simple reminder for us that it is the light of Christ in our lives that we're invited to share. Let's stand together as we sing. Boys and girls aged 3 to 8, you are dismissed for Bethany Kids as the 3 to 6-year-olds, Junior Gems and Cadets, the 7 and 8-year-olds. If you're new here or visiting here this morning, you'd like to have your children part of those programs, you're welcome to go. Make sure you've signed them in, and if you haven't, please just go with them and do so. They're also welcome to stay here with you, that's fine too. Invite the deacons forward at this time for our offering. Our offerings this morning, the first is for the ministries here at Bethany and the Christian Reformed Church that we're a part of. We covenant together to give in proportion to how God has blessed us. That means in a percentage, a tithe of what God has given us. We encourage each other to give in that. And the second is for NACE, for Covenant Christian School, as we continue to participate in what God is doing in the His Lordship over all of life, including in education. We celebrate and give thanks in our giving. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the light that you give us to shine. We thank you that you invite us into a fellowship of believers, into a place and a time that together we can encourage and walk with each other as we walk in this world for you. We thank you, Lord, for the ministries you lead us in here in Bethany and in the Christian Reformed Church. And we thank you also, Lord, for the gift of a place like Covenant Christian School and the other Christian schools in the area. We're grateful for the freedom we have, Lord, to be able to explore your creation from the perspective of you as Lord of life, the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sanctifier. And so, Lord, bless that school. Bless our giving with encouragement, Lord, that it may be something that continues to be a part of our growing stewardship and our growing generosity as your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. As we come to prayer, just a prayer item to share that Tim Van Hoffen's mother was diagnosed with cancer. So to keep his mom and she's the caregiver for her dad, for their dad. So just to keep that family in prayer as they begin to walk a difficult journey. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Holy Father, you have given us the light of your love in the face of Jesus. By the presence of your Holy Spirit, and as we sang, this little light of mine, it's the gift you've given us. We want to thank you for that light. Lord, we know at times in our lives that light blazes forward. It's bright, it's there, it's present. We are walking with you in joy. We're reminded by all kinds of things how you're at work in our lives, and it fills us with encouragement. And Lord, we also know at other times in our lives the light seems so distant, maybe very small. Sometimes even we lose track of it, and darkness seems to be our friend. But Lord, we recognize that the light is not from us, it's from you. And so as we sang, nothing can blow it out. Nothing can separate us from you in Christ. It's an awesome reminder, Lord. We thank you for that gift, and we pray for one another. We pray for the many and varied journeys that we're on, ourselves, our loved ones. Lord, some are wonderful times of life, times of fruitfulness and times of family and great relationships and work that is blessing us. All these and schools we go so freely to, Lord, all these things are wonderful gifts from you. But we also have times, Lord, where it's dark, where it's painful, where we're in fear and where we're wondering, Lord, what happens next. And Lord, at times when this world and everything that's happening in it is so confusing, times when our own lives, Lord, struggle, in those times too, Lord, we turn to you. We recognize you never leave us, never forsake us. That was your promise. So, Lord, be near us and help us to be near to one another. For you bring all this variety together into the bodies of Christ that meet, the parts that are in different congregations. You bring us together so that we might walk together in life and uphold each other. We thank you for that. We pray, Lord, for the council as they meet tomorrow, as they together are, they serve in your name for that to happen, striving to help us as believers grow in our faith. Just give them what is needed by your Holy Spirit, guidance and wisdom in all things. Lord, we want to continue to pray for Devin and Loretto and their next steps for them, Lord. Watch over them as they still await being able to be together again. Continue to strengthen them. Lord, we want to pray for little Dylan and his parents and siblings. Lord, patience for him, for this journey of physio, medications, and waiting, Lord, and not at home in his own place, and for them as family too, traveling back and forth. And we pray, Lord, for peace of heart and mind, for continued measures of healing for Dylan, and for, Lord, the joy of the Lord in him and in all of the family. And Lord, we pray for Greg and his new round of treatments, for relief from side effects, Lord, and we pray for healing and for hope for him and for his family, hope in you to hold him and his family in your gracious care. We know, Lord, you are sovereign over all things. You can do all things. So we turn this to you and ask for your grace present there. Lord, we pray for Jack, grateful, able to come home again as he continues his cancer journey. Lord, watch over him and his family. May they, too, experience your nearness in new and in ways that perhaps they didn't know before. And Lord, for Tim's mother, we pray for her as well and for that family and for his father and Lord, we know that that word cancer is such a devastating word. But Lord, these things too are in your hands, and so we lift them up to you. And Lord, there is much confusion in this world. There's much confusion for us. There's shock and grief. We think of the accident in Humboldt, Saskatchewan. And Lord, we have nothing to say for meaning for that, but we cry out to you for the families, for the community of Humboldt. Lord, for all who have been deeply affected, Lord, in hearing the news of such a tragedy, Lord, we recognize that yet in this broken world, you have not abandoned it. So we pray, Lord, that in these things too, your kingdom may come. The light of the love of God may shine in these difficult times and places. We pray for your comforting grace and peace that goes beyond understanding, to surround the families as they mourn. We pray for healing and care for those who are injured. And we ask also, Lord, that you be near to the driver of the transport. For Lord, the weight of guilt and the weight of pain for him as well, or her, we don't know, Lord, but we ask that you just be near to them, that you watch over them, and that you care for him and his family. And Lord, we think of what's been going on still in Syria, Lord. We are grateful for an end to one war, and it seems a new one is arising. And Lord, we just pray for peace. We pray for just and compassionate restoration of a good government, of healing for communities. We pray for protection for the vulnerable. And Lord, there are still so many fleeing and looking for a place to go, and we're thankful to be part of helping. And so, Lord, we pray for your blessing on a Syrian new coming family, the Al-Zain family, and we ask, Lord, that as we prepare as a community of churches and as a community of Pelham to receive them, Lord, and uphold them and support them, that everything will be in place. And that, Lord, they will receive this as a blessing, and they may come also to know what a wonderful God you are. Lord, there is many other things in this world going on. You know them, and we see them. We ask, Lord, that you give us hearts to pray. Pray for one another and pray in opportunities for anyone who comes to us, Lord, that we be bold to take the time to pray when called upon. And that, Lord, our hearts may continue to seek your presence and seek your voice in our lives through your word and through your presence in so many ways. And now, Lord, too, as we turn to your word, we ask for your grace to be present, that you minister to us in this means of grace, Lord, and that you illumine our hearts by your Spirit, that you speak to us what the truth is of your good news, and in any way that we need to hear it, that we may be continually transformed, we may be drawn close to you by the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's turn to God's Word. I invite you to turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6, page 5 at the start of the Bible. We're continuing on with our exploration through the first number of chapters in the book of Genesis. Genesis 6. Reading the first 8 verses. When men began to increase in number on the earth, and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were beautiful, and they married any of them they chose. Then the Lord said, "My spirit will not contend with man forever, for he is mortal. His days will be 120 years." The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God went to the daughters of men and had children by them. They were the heroes of old, men of renown. The Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. And the Lord was grieved that he had made man on the earth, and his heart was filled with pain. So the Lord said, "I will wipe mankind, whom I have created from the face of the earth, men and animals and creatures that move along the ground and birds of the air, for I am grieved that I have made them." But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Fellow said to his neighbor, looking at his lawn, he said, "That's a little bit of overkill, don't you think?" They stood together at what was his front lawn. It was completely dead, not a blade of green everywhere on it, anywhere. The neighbor had sprayed his lawn with Roundup, and it killed everything. "I mean, you just had a few of those pesky weeds in that one spot, didn't you? Why'd you spray the whole thing? Isn't that sort of overdoing it?" Well, the neighbor stared at his lawn and slowly shook his head. "No, I did what I had to be done. You just don't know this weed like I do. No matter how much I pulled it out, it grows back and spreads more. And if you spray the handful of weeds dead here, it just keeps coming up somewhere else in the lawn. So no, the only way to deal with this weed was to kill everything." I feel like that with my lawn sometimes. But it's a bit of overkill, wouldn't it be? to do that. I ever wonder if God sending the flood to destroy every living creature was a bit of overkill? I mean, was humanity in that day so much worse than today or in the centuries after the flood? Is God just being mean? Does God have the right to do this? Is this really who God is, or was this just sort of an overreaction to sin that God later promised not to do again? I mean, the world flood was so long ago, most people consider it maybe an ancient myth, and we can even easily miss the seriousness of what was going to happen in chapter 6. Now, this morning we begin with the prelude, the introduction to the flood. Is this really our God? Verses 1 to 8, they're kind of strange verses, aren't they? However, they do indeed answer the question of overkill or overreaction. Questions of God's justice in the face of our sin. Question of these verses in how they show the contrast, the stark contrast between what God has in store because of our sin and His grace and what that is. But these are strange verses. I hope you have it open in front of you and just kind of looking through it. We live in a film society, don't we? In a society that puts on the big screens all kinds of fanciful stories and legends. And so we may naturally tend to read these eight verses as some kind of once upon a time start to the account of the flood. Or we want to take this as a part of real history, and then we get a little bit caught up in trying to figure out who are these sons of gods and sons of God and the daughters of men, and who are the Nephilim and these heroes of old, men of renown. And so we come at this text from a modern standpoint. We're kind of wondering about answer to these questions. But if for those of you who are here for some of this series, you remember, we got to remember, first of all, we have to recognize this as an ancient text. And Moses, the author of the first five books of the Bible, he intentionally includes these verses. But he didn't do it to spark our curiosity or to just give us some interesting historical tidbits. No, these verses are continuing the account of God's self-revelation of who He is, what His salvation is, and what He has promised to His fallen creatures. Now, this kind of picks up at the end of chapter 4. Chapter 5 had the list of names we looked at. But the end of chapter 4 is the line of Seth where it says, "And men began to, at that time, men began to call on the name of the Lord." They began to worship God. They continued in their labor and painful toil caused by the curse on sin that Adam and Eve brought upon creation in their rebellion against God. And we know that the line, the violent and vengeful line of Cain, also continues to grow and spread over the earth. And if you recall, the roots of sin and misery are deepening and are impossible for humanity to overcome. And death comes to all. Even longevity of life is cut off eventually by death. So now Moses writes, chapter 6, verse 1, he says, "When men began to increase in number on the earth, and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were beautiful, and they married any of them they chose." So humanity is still growing in number. They are spreading over the earth. God's command to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth is still pushing forward. The first obvious question we have, though, are who are these sons of God? Now, there have been throughout history a couple of different interpretations. Each has some support elsewhere in the scriptures and in history of the church, but no one interpretation is completely satisfactory, perhaps. But in Moses' day, you have to realize the Israelites understood what Moses meant, and so no further explanation was required. However, we would love a bit more detail, wouldn't we? But this is what we get. It's all what we get. So let's see if we can understand God's word here in its context. Now remember, I mentioned before that the writing in Scripture, especially in Hebrew writing in the Old Testament, writes very sparsely. Everything there is on there on purpose. There's no extra stuff flourished that should have been left on the editor floor or something. It's all there on purpose, guided by the Holy Spirit. So the word for God in the sons of God, we need to know which word is this. This is the Hebrew word Elohim, which is the word in the Old Testament mostly translated as God, the Creator. The word is actually a plural word, So in a number of places in the Old Testament, the same word is translated as gods with small g and is in plural. The NIV has it here with a capital G, referring to the Creator, and this is one valid choice. Now, if we take this to be the word God with a capital G, then the sons of God may be those who worshipped God, namely the line of Seth. We had those two lines contrasted just before. And they saw the daughters of men, the line of Cain, those who were not following the Lord, and they were drawn by their beauty to marry them, and it says, any of them as they chose. Now, this is not some innocent romantic happening. This is part of the demonstration of the escalating rebellion against God's way, the escalating wickedness of humankind. Now, remember, the Israelites would hear this when Moses brought this to them. They would hear for sure the warning that God gave them again and again not to marry into the nations around them. Now, that was not a matter of staying within your own ethnic people. That was about accepting the gods of the nations, which were intertwined with being a part of the families of those nations. I mean, foreigners could join with Israel and become Israelites as they would worship God. Consider Ruth, who was a Moabite and became an Israelite. But Israelites were not to become Assyrian or Babylonian or Canaanite or Hittite or Egyptian. These were in those days as much religious designations as they were national ones. Each nation had its own set of gods. To be Egyptian was to worship the Egyptian gods. That's what made you Egyptian. So this flirting and mingling with the surrounding religions landed Israel in a whole heap of trouble again and again because they had been set apart by God for God alone. They were to worship Him and Him alone. Well, here we find already before the flood, the followers of the Lord, those called by God to be His people, wander away and enter into fellowship with other gods, the other people, the daughters of men it was called. And this is one way of understanding what Moses is telling us. That this problem of flirting with the gods around us, of intertwining our lives with ways and means that the Lord has not called us to, is ever present with us. And it keeps growing. Now, if we do the other translation, we take the word Elohim to mean gods, simply plural, small g, then we have the ancient Old Testament notion of the great men being godlike in the context of this world. And many ancient commentaries on this passage even went further and said these were so great, these were like fallen angels who were intermarrying with human women. Now, that view really has no support in Scripture elsewhere, but it does kind of appeal to people today because it sounds like a good movie. But the word, if it's God, small g, plural, so that it's the sons of gods saw that the daughters of men were beautiful and they married any of them they chose, then what we have is still the increasing wickedness as powerful people, perhaps even by cooperation with demons, take power and begin to rule others by force and violence, and they married any of them they chose is an echo of Lamech, the Canaanite, the descendant of Cain who tells his wives that he does what he pleases. Now, what is more clearly present in the text in Hebrew is lost a little bit in English. Verse 2 literally says this, the sons of God, or gods, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were good, and they took any of them as they chose. Now, the use of the word saw, good, and took is a clear hearkening back to chapter 3, verse 6, when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and she took some and ate it. It's a very deliberate echo. Moses is saying what is going on here is in keeping with the rebellion from the beginning. Moses is highlighting is that humanity by chapter 6 has continued in the same pattern of rebellion against God. They are still seeing, desiring that it's good for them and taking for themselves. And now it's multiple wives and any of them they chose. Chaos, immorality is growing. You can almost see here already the objectifying of women into sex objects that we are so familiar with. It's considered acceptable and normal. They become chattel. They become not what God intended them to be. One desires what one wants, yet that's most important. So however we interpret those persons, the God or gods, it's clear that rebellion against God's created norms and laws is growing. Now verse 4 is of the chapter 6 here, The four verses, the first ones, are also structured in such a way that the first and last parts are similar, so that it's the center that is highlighted. That's a common writing pattern in the Bible. And so we have the sons of God seeing what they want and taking, and then in verse 4 you read, the Nephilim were on the earth in those days, also afterward, when the sons of God went to the daughters of men, had children by them. They were the heroes of old, the men of renown. So those two halves of those first four verses, they're echoing each other. They're repeating kind of the same thing. Because we could think of these heroes of old as great men who did good things for humanity, you know, who we hold up and say, boy, that's a wonderful person. However, that doesn't fit what Moses is explaining. You see, these heroes are the progeny of power and violence growing in the world. They are the powerful ones who, in the ancient world context, are known because they conquer. That's the men of renown. They conquer other lands. These are warriors and kings and rulers who overran and destroyed wherever they went. They enslaved others. They became known for their military exploits. They were fearless, including no fear of the Lord. The ancient world held them up as heroes. They were the inspiration to further grabbing at power and might in one's own strength. And the ancient nations in Israel's day all had tales of these heroes of old. The Nephilim were part of those stories, great men, perhaps even giants like Goliath, who was later explained to be a descendant of Anak, who was part of the Nephilim peoples. Again, we have no details, but the point isn't the details of what these Nephilim looked like. The point is the growing wickedness of all of humanity, even in their most powerful ways. Including even what the world would hold up as divine, as heroes of old. Humanity continues to reach beyond themselves, striving to totally replace God's rule in this world by their own might, their own ingenuity, their own power of reason, or we might say trying to replace God with their own strength and technology and science and wealth and education, or whatever you want to use to lift yourself up. We don't need God in our world. We can overcome all adversity and bring the kingdom of humanity to the whole world. You hear a familiarity in there? We're still tempted today to live for ourselves, to live by ourselves. Even today we worship God on Sunday, but really we don't have really a lot of problem flirting with the daughters of the world, so to speak. We flirt with materialism, putting our trust for daily life in our wealth, and we're sure it all belongs to us. We flirt with ease and pleasure as if they will bring us peace, as if that's the goal in life. In fact, immorality is so acceptable to our senses. Think of this, if you would honestly track how many times throughout a day or throughout a week that sex is used to sell something, if you really closely track that, you would be shocked, and we should be appalled at how we have perverted what God created as wholesome and pure. And we go through life probably more feeling like we're victims of what's going around us than sinners before God. We're good people who have just some struggles, and who doesn't have struggles? It's not so bad, and everyone's allowed a few vices, we say at times. It just keeps you humble, and so we lose our ability to discern sin from God's perspective, and we lose our sensitivity to evil and more easily stand by, even participate in it. Well, Moses is saying, this is nothing new. This is the result of this fallenness of humanity. Before the flood, the world was caught up in humanity's willful sinning. And those who sinned with flair and power, they were held up as heroes. I mean, think of who we look up to today in our society. Well, God responds to this reality of humanity. Verse 3. Then the Lord said, my spirit will not contend with man forever, for he is mortal. His days will be 120 years. And this central verse in the first section gets expanded in the second section. Verse 5 says, the Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. What an incredible way to describe that. How desperately lost we are. Man's wickedness of the earth had become that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. That's not us. That can't be me. That can't be me. No, I have good thoughts. But this is honesty about what sin is. I mean, we tend to want to say, no, we're generally good people, everyone's good people, and God's salvation, that's kind of a help we add on sort of thing. But humanity and the good things we find in people are not the result of us just doing something really well, that we, by our own decision and power and will, have straightened out ourselves. This is what we in our rebellion against the supreme ruler want to think. We want to think, you know, the goodness in the world, the good things we can do, we did that. And so we want to think that also earns something with God. We're always drawn to the idea. We're always drawn again and again to the belief that if we just try harder, if we only get right chances, maybe we can even get a leg up somehow, we will be able to get ourselves well enough. We'll save ourselves from our own brokenness and sin. We'll be able to set ourselves apart for God, and we can be religious and righteous before God by our own efforts. All the wonderful things we find in ourselves and in others, we're pretty sure we did that. And then it makes it very difficult when we have the brokenness in our lives that's overwhelming us to come and talk about that, to share that with one another, because we're so sure that everyone else is thinking, well, then fix it. Fix it yourself. Because we tend to drift toward that ourselves. It's that rebellion against God and wanting to do your own life for yourself in your own way. But Moses is not telling Israel, the Spirit of God is not telling us, well, the pre-flood world was really bad. Good thing we aren't that like that anymore. Good thing we're better. We now earn God's favor. We're acceptable to Him. We fix things up. No, He's saying we find our world, our sin, our rebellion right here today. Reflected in these words. There is no hope of wholeness and restoration in humanity by itself. Even with all the power that we can come up with. The Nephilim, the renowned people of old, the powerful ones, the great ones. It's wickedness that dominates. We are far from God's original design. So far that Moses writes in verse 6, the Lord was grieved that He had made man on the earth, and His heart was filled with pain. Now that seems at first strange way to speak of the Creator, of God who knows all, has been from all eternity. Why describe God's judgment decision in this fashion? Moses could have said, and God in His holiness, His perfect pureness required purity in His presence, and wicked humanity fully deserved to be put out of His presence forever. We would have said, okay, that makes sense, but He doesn't say that. He says the Lord was grieved. And that is what God decides. Verse 7, it says, so God said, I will wipe mankind whom I have created from the face of the earth, men and animals and creatures that move along the ground, birds of the air, for I am grieved that I have made them. Actually, I read that long. It actually doesn't say God said, does it? It says, the Lord said. Remember, while paying attention carefully to the names of God used, remember that the use of the name of God is significant. The Lord, this is Yahweh. This is the covenant name of God, the Lord. And Moses uses this at this time. This is before God makes His covenant, reveals Himself as I am to Israel. But he uses this very intentionally. This is like saying, your covenant Father in heaven said, I am grieved. He uses this language to describe God's reaction to human rebellion. God, he's telling Israel, he's telling us, he's reminding us that God is the Father. He's pained and grieved because those who are precious to Him, His children, have turned on Him, despised Him, mocked Him, slapped Him in the face, and spit on Him. And they falsely accuse Him of unjust overkill and outright reject His rule and authority. Are we describing the ancient world or today? Isn't it both? And it's the loving Creator, our Father, who is pained by humanity's hatred of Him. Moses is telling us that the coming account of the flood is not some arbitrary violence perpetrated on the world by some psycho god. This is not the raging fury of some god who's had enough. This is the pained response of a covenant Father. The flood is not some unjust punishment, but is right and just and a necessary response to the evil of our hearts. So pervasive is this evil and sin in us that it taints all of creation. Even the animals are drawn into this destruction that humanity brings on itself. And it's that creation will be undone. Chaos will return. God will not hold back the result of sin. Verse 3, his days will be 120 years. Now this can mean either days until the coming of the flood or the years of life of human beings being shortened. Either way, God's judgment of death draws near. And death is earned by us all right up to today. History vindicates our rebellion without doubt, and our personal and willful involvement with sin is obvious to each and every one of us if we are the least bit honest. The whole of fallen creation does not deserve to continue in this rebellion. And sin cannot be pulled out by us, no matter how great a hero, a giant, or godlike leader may try. All is lost, except one thing. God had made a promise of a Savior, the seed of woman, which would one day come and crush the head of the seed of the serpent. The defeat of sin, the defeat of Satan, the defeat of the curse of death itself. And that hope of grace comes to us in verse 8. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. And again, it's not the eyes of God, Elohim, it's the eyes of the Lord, Yahweh, the Old Testament covenant name of God. This is the ancient expression that goes, if I have found favor in your eyes, have mercy on me. It's not the modern expression of, if I have earned your favor. It's not that. Noah did something to earn this favor. Noah discovers favor in the eyes of the Lord. You see, Noah's no different from all other sinners. If you're not sure of that, read a little farther into Genesis, find out what happens after the flood. You find out he's no different. It's like saying Noah discovered that the God who rightly could bring this judgment on the world discovered that he also granted favor, discovered grace in the gaze of the covenant God of the promises of the Messiah. This is the biblical teaching of God's unearned grace that comes to rescue us from sin and death. Noah was certainly one who sought to worship the Lord, but he did not make God his covenant Lord. God made Noah his covenant recipient. And Noah was responding in worship. In the middle of the growing, out-of-control rebellion of sin in this world, God comes as Lord. He comes as with a covenant of peace and restoration with those he calls and those who come. And this covenant, based on the promises in the Garden of Eden to one day defeat Satan, sin, death, is fulfilled in the coming of Yahweh in Christ Jesus, who is God with us. Jesus, he too experienced exactly this. He was rejected by his own people. He was mocked and spit on and slapped. He was tortured. Even his own disciples fled in fear of the worldly powers. They fled in fear of the Nephilim of the day, Rome. And alone, Jesus was executed outside the chosen city of God, outside of the temple, outside of Jerusalem. And yet this very Jesus, who was no sinner, but was our brother in humanity, is also our covenant Lord who came to save us from the coming final judgment of God. Jesus defeated Satan's hold through rising from the dead, and now we live, followers of the Lord, those who call on the name of the Lord, we live by the grace of God, the favor we find in the Lord. And we await the return of Christ, who will once and for all finish the judgment of the living and the dead. The Lord has set the number of years that are left before Christ returns. And in this time before that, we are offered the favor of the Lord. The favor in the eyes of the Lord. For when we look to the Lord, we see the eyes of Jesus. We see the one who died for us. So we are invited to accept this gift of the favor of Yahweh, the favor of the covenant God in Christ Jesus, and invited to enter into His embrace and to respond and to live as those rescued from sin and death by God Himself. Even though we all fully deserve God's judgment, this is not our doing. This is but our responding to the grace given so freely. We're called to live by faith in Christ, not putting our trust in the Nephilim or the heroes of our day. We are called to not follow after the world and growing wickedness, but to seek the Lord and His ways in thankfulness that He has come and granted us favor, grace, and forgiveness of our sins. For Christ has died, and Christ has risen, and Christ will come again, the promised one of old. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we need Your Holy Spirit to continue to show us the two sides of this incredible work of Yours. One, the reality of our need of You, of our sinfulness, to be honest with one another, to be open and to let that turn our hearts to You. And we need to see also the amazingness of Your freely given grace, the forgiveness of our sin that sets us free, that gives us renewed life, that puts away shame and darkness. Lord, we need that every day in differing measures for each of us. We ask, Lord, that You lead and guide us in that, and that as Your people we may bear witness to this grace, not out of arrogance, not out of our own strength, but out of the power of Your Holy Spirit at work here in us and in this world. And we thank You for that good news, and we look forward to the day when we will see the favor of our Lord face to face in the eyes of our Savior Jesus. Uphold us for Your glory and use us for Your purposes until Your kingdom comes in all its fullness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's rise together and receive God's word of blessing from Romans 15. Please stand. As you enter into the week that the Lord has laid before you, in all the different things that you are called to do, not do, to be, and places you go, may these words, the word of our Lord, walk with you. May the God of all hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ and to the glory of our Heavenly Father. God's people say, Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace to rain.